Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Welcome on this Easter morning as we gather for worship and to be witness and bear witness to this resurrection moment. As we gather today, just a few announcements to touch on. We are going to be communing a little bit differently today. In light of the festivity and the wonder of resurrection, our wine and our grape juice is going to be a little more sparkling and a little more lively than usual. So, what that does mean, and for all of you to take note of, is rather than our usual, our colors have changed. So now the red is grape juice and the white is wine. We have already have one resurrection surprise. We don't need a second one. So I am Pastor Chris Thomas, and it is my joy to be here with you as we gather to worship. As we enter into this service today, I hope that it is a joy-filled day and a reminder of God's continuous blessing upon our lives. But let us first gather together and give thanks for the gift of baptism that God has placed within our lives. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the wellspring of grace, our Easter and our joy. Amen. Look, here is water. Here is our water of life. Alleluia. Refreshed by the resurrection life that we share in Christ, let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We thank you, risen Christ, for these waters where you make us new, leading us from death into life, from tears into joy. We bless you, risen Christ, that your Spirit comes to us in the grace-filled waters of rebirth, like rains to our thirsting earth, like streams that revive our souls, like cups of cool water shared with strangers. Breathe your peace on your church when we hide in fear. Clothe us with your mercy and forgiveness, and send us companions on our journey as we share your life. Make us one, risen Christ, and cleanse our hearts. Shower us with life. To you be given all praise with the Holy Spirit in the glory of God now and forever. Amen. Alleluia. Amen. Let us stand and sing as we open with song.
Hope you're awake, because this is going to be a little fast.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
And let us join together and pray. O God, you gave your only Son to suffer death on the cross for our redemption. And by his glorious resurrection, you delivered us from the power of death. Make us die every day to sin, that we may live with him forever in the joy of the resurrection. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us be seated as we hear our first lesson today.
The first lesson comes from Isaiah chapter 25, starting at verse 6. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wine strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said that on this day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our second lesson comes from Acts chapter 10, starting at verse 34. Peter began to speak to the people. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit, with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Stand for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the 16th chapter. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they may go and anoint Jesus' body. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place where they laid him, but go. Tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated, and grace and peace to you from God, our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Any kids who want to come up for a children's message, I'd love to have you join me up here. Come on up, guys. Can we have a seat around here? Hey, guys. All right, you can come over here. All right, guys. So I have a little Easter basket here, and this is my little Easter basket for Holy Week. Each of these eggs represents one of the big things that happened this week. You guys all see them? We have a couple of different colors. We have a pink, a yellow, a green, an orange, and kind of a pinkish purple, huh? Yeah. Well, let's start our pink one. This is, do you guys remember, all the way back so long ago to last Sunday. Do you guys remember what happened last Sunday? Well, no, that's coming up later. We had
Palm Sunday,
right? We had palms, and we were waving our palms, and these are some of the palms that are left over from that day. And then, on Thursday of this week, we heard the story of Jesus having a meal with his disciples, and so we have a little communion cup right here, a reminder of that meal. Because when we join around our communion table, that's just like when Jesus met with his disciples. And here, this is from Good Friday. Anyone want to guess what we have in here? No guesses? We have a cross. Because on Good Friday is the day that we remember Jesus' death and God's great love for us. And so we have a cross and we can see Jesus on the cross, right in that one, huh? And our next egg here, this one's a little heavier. I want to take a guess what's in here.
Candy?
Not candy. This would be a rough candy. This is a rock. Because after Jesus was taken off the cross, they took him and they laid him in a tomb and they rolled a big rock, a lot bigger than this. This wouldn't do much to cover anything, right? A much bigger rock, and they put it in front of Jesus' tomb so that no one would disturb his body. But then today, for Sunday, what do you think we have in here?
Easter.
It is Easter. So what is in our egg?
A bunny.
A bunny is a good guess.
Jesus,
that'd be a good guess. We're going with Jesus again. Double down on Jesus. That's a good idea. Let's see. It's empty. It's empty. Just like in our gospel today when Mary, two different Marys, and Salome were going to the tomb and they were going to see Jesus' body and to help prepare it. And they got there and the big stone was rolled out of the way and the tomb was completely empty. He was gone. And so they didn't know what to do. And then a young man came up to them and said, "Are you looking for Jesus? He's not here. He's gone ahead of you to Galilee. Go and tell his disciples that he's risen." And that's a message that we get to share too. We get to carry that same message that Jesus is not still in the tomb. There's not still a rock blocking it, but he is risen indeed. And that is why we celebrate this Easter. More than just bunnies and eggs or anything like that, we celebrate that Jesus, our Savior, is alive. Will you guys pray with me?
Dear God,
thank you for Jesus,
for resurrection,
and new life.
Help us
carry this message
so all will hear it.
Amen. Thank you so much for coming up, guys. I have to say that of the four Gospels, the Gospel of Mark and the resurrection story that's within it is hands down my favorite Gospel to hear when we have this early Easter. Because when we have April Fool's Day just tomorrow, it is a very interesting Gospel to hold in tension with that. Because do me a favor and listen to the last verse of this Gospel one more time. So they went out and they fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anybody, for they were afraid. How do you end a gospel like this? An Easter story where the resurrected Jesus doesn't show up, where the women who witness it don't run to the disciples to tell them what they have found, but instead they run away and they don't say anything to anyone. A story not of hope and of joy, but of terror and amazement. Does it seem a little bit like Mark is playing an April Fool's joke? Like there's really just a secret extra gospel that you turn the page to? But if only there was one more verse, something that said, you know, April Fools'eth, the women went and found the risen Jesus and then told all of the disciples what they found and everything was great. But Mark is not fooling with us. Now, there are other endings to the Gospel of Mark. And it's an interesting thing that if you open your Bible and you go to that last chapter of Mark, you'll see this ending of the first 8 verses, then you'll see one bracket, and then you'll see another bracket. And two of those are written in, and kind of the prevailing thought is that at some point a scribe was writing down the Gospel of Mark and then suddenly looked and said, well, we can't end with this. So we know when we read Matthew and when we read John, these other things happened, so we'll just kind of fill in a little bit of the blank here. And so they jotted down a little bit more of a complete ending to the text, but our oldest, our most complete manuscripts from the Gospel of Mark, the ones that we can technically trust the most, they don't have a single iota of a word after verse 8. So like it or not, in the Gospel of Mark, Easter morning comes not with this joyous celebration of finding the risen Christ, but with the terror and amazement of finding that he's not where we expected him to be. As if to say, "Alleluia, now run away." And yet I wonder if this isn't an important gospel for us to heed, particularly in this time. And not just because tomorrow is April 1st, but because this is such a real and profoundly honest gospel, I feel. I mean, do we really think that we would behave much differently than these women when they come face to face with what they've experienced? When we face the honesty of it, the surprise, it's easy to cry alleluia at resurrection when we are thousands of years removed from the situation, but to be right there, to approach the tomb carrying these burial spices in hand, wondering how is it that this stone is ever even going to be moved away, and then to see it, that it was moved, rolled off to the side, rushing up to the empty tomb to find that the body you had come to honor, that it was gone. And there, this strange man starts to tell you that Jesus is alive. He's out and about. You just missed him, guys. I mean, if you hurry up, you might catch him. He's heading to Galilee. Resurrection, it's a terrifying thing when we think about it. Our expectations of what we are to see, they all get flipped on their head. It pushes back against everything that we know about this world. Death is frightening. And as we have journeyed throughout this week and as we've experienced Good Friday and the recognition of Jesus' death on the cross, we recognize death. It is known to us. We experience it. It is an understood fact of our lives. And in a way, it is easier. It is simpler because it doesn't surprise us. We may hate it. We may push back against it with all that we have, but we understand it. And I want you to take a second and really think about something. In just this past week, how often has death been a part of a conversation? Whether it was a story from the news, whether it is something within your own life, something within our community. Please don't misunderstand me. It is a terrible and heartbreaking thing, but it is known to us, sometimes too well. I mean, as Benjamin Franklin said, as we are approaching April right around the corner here, there's only two things that are certain in life, death and taxes. And we may not like it, but we certainly have gotten used to it. Death, that is. I don't know about the getting used to taxes. but resurrection, this empty tomb, this risen Christ, it is both terrifying and amazing because it takes our world and our understanding and it flips it upside down. Because if that is true and if it happened, then we're looking at this in a completely different way. It means that those things that we have grown so comfortable with, the times that we just want to throw in the towel and say, I'm done with this, when we wonder what is the point of even trying, the moments when we feel so small, so weak, so beaten down by what life throws at us, those times that it hurts more than we let on, that all of that is just momentary. It's the great April Fool's joke of life, that if we thought that that's all we might get, that when we least expect it, when the pain is so deep, when the doubt tends to be so strong, when just showing up is sometimes the most we could ever possibly manage, carrying spices that we don't even know how we're going to use, we find that the tomb is empty and we come face to face with a new reality that we were not at all ready for. Because resurrection means that those times of pain, of sorrow, of doubt, of worry, of strife, and of loss, those feelings that seem to pervade our lives, that stalk us from the shadows, that they do not get to win. Because an empty tomb and a risen Christ, a Savior on the move, means that resurrection is in our very blood. So if we lean into this very frightening and unknown thing called resurrection, if we let it take hold of us, to take root and grow up within us, it changes who we are. We have a Savior who took on a cross to kill our sin, who came back from the grave to give us life in a new way that we did not think was possible. So my friends, when we join together to say, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
There we go. When we sing out our alleluias, alleluia, we give this thing called resurrection some room to grow. And if we water it with baptism and we nourish it with the meal that we gather around at this table in communion, my friends, it can change everything. It is the final laugh in the face of death. This is the Easter message that Mark gives to us. So what are we to do with this message of hope, this message of new life? These women were told to go and find the disciples and Peter and to share the word, even to those who had abandoned Jesus, to go especially to Peter who had denied him 3 times. They also have to know the truth. To know that their Savior lives, to go and make sure that they don't get fooled by this messaging of death, that there's something better in this world. And if you want to see that risen Savior, he says, go back to Galilee, return to the beginning, to the place where the sick found renewed health, where the captive found freedom, where, yes, even the dead found new life, because it's there that you will find him moving. And this may be exactly the gospel that we need to hear. We don't shout alleluia for a Christ who waits at the tomb to be found. No, we serve a God who goes out ahead, who goes first to make a path for us to follow in, that this is the good news of Easter. So even if the women find themselves terrified, and why shouldn't they? Even if they run, even if the disciples are stuck there, sitting in an upper room waiting for the news, even if Peter has not yet heard resurrection means he isn't beyond hope, even with all of that, it may be the end of this text, but it is not the end of this gospel. Because this calling, this sharing of the good news, this opportunity to step into this story of new life, it passes now to us. And so what are we to do with it? There are some who think that Mark ends his gospel this way intentionally, that the goal is to say they ran and they told no one so that we would see the abruptness, the jarring ending, And so that the people who were hearing these words, the audience who heard it spoken, that they would stand in astonishment, hearing that they found an empty tomb, that they were given this job of carrying the message out, this message of hope and wonder, and yet it was left undone. And so we who hear it now, we have nothing more to say than to stand and say, if they're not going to do it, then I will. Mark wants us not to be fooled. He wants to draw us into this story. He wants to give us a role to play in this great arc of God's redemption, to be a resurrection people, to recognize that we have a story to tell, to go on and join in this chorus of Alleluia. And so, my friends, he is risen. May that message not just stay in this room, but may it be on our lips as we go forth. May we embark to share this message of the profound thing that our Savior was once dead but is now alive. And may we live into the hope that that resurrection brings, that death does not get the last laugh, and that life and life abundant is our gift from God. Amen.
Please stand.
join together sharing our faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Rejoicing that Jesus is risen and love has triumphed over fear, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need of good news. Holy God, we pray for the body of Christ, the church, where the church is persecuted, protect it; where the church is privileged, grant it humility; where the church is fractured, heal it. Guide us all to embody Christ's love in the world. God of grace, life-giving God, we pray for the earth, your good creation. Join our prayers with branches lifted in praise and roaring waters of new life, that together we may proclaim Easter hope. God of grace, merciful God, we pray for all peoples and nations. Free those peoples suffering under oppression, exploitation, and abuse. Teach leaders your way of justice. Empower peacemakers and all who work to end violence and strife. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Liberating God, we pray for people everywhere who long for good news. Roll away the stones that keep people from living with dignity and wholeness. Breathe new life and hope into people struggling to make it through each day. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Loving God, we pray for this community of faith and all who enter into this Easter season with weighed down by grief and sorrow. Help us to see your spirit in our midst. Feed us at your Easter table and fill us with your wisdom, that we may serve and care for others. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Eternal God, we remember those who have gone before us in death. Renew our trust in your promises, that we live with joyful courage and compassion, and help our belief that as you have defeated death and the grave, we all know, all will know the power of resurrection. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love, through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord. Amen.
Now may the peace of Christ be with you all. Let us share a sign of Christ's peace with one another. We give thanks for the good gifts of a plentiful table and for those gifts that have been provided. And we give thanks knowing that they start in their centering, coming to God and finding their way to us so that they might be shared with the rest of this world. So let us lift up these resources and gifts as we pray. Risen One, you call us to believe and to bear fruit. May the gifts that we offer here be signs of your abiding love. Form us to be your witnesses in the world through Jesus Christ, our true vine. Amen. As we gather around our table today, again, a reminder of our change in our grape juice and wine, but also a reminder that as we gather around this table, we invite all who are here to partake. If you would like to commune from your seat, you are welcome to do that. There are pre-filled cups at the entrances, and I will invite you to commune at the very end. But as we gather together for this meal, let us give thanks to God for its gift in our life. And so may the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, with the angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as our Lord has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. My friends, the risen Christ has made known to us in the breaking of the bread, so come and eat at God's table. May we taste grace and salvation and know that resurrection is a hope that is ours. I'll invite our communion assistants forward at this time. And as they're coming forward, just a note, we'll have two stations, one on either side of the font, and a third station for gluten-free, which will be over on the side by where the band is playing.
High the mountain, I could not climb.
and eat the body of Christ given for you.
The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you.
And take and drink the blood of Christ shed for you. And now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen us and keep us in his grace. And alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. The God of resurrection power, the Christ of unending joy, and the Spirit of Easter hope bless you now and always. Amen. Amen. Let us go forth singing Revelation song.
Please stand.
To him.
rejoice and be glad.